confirmed COVID-19.
People can't be brought in every night under the cover of darkness.
The arrival of our guest that day was no different to other travellers.
We shouldn't have been allowed to dock anywhere.
The stakes are very, very high.
Restricting movement will stop the spread.
They let 2,700 people disembark.
This is huge.
This is a capital F for failure.
A catastrophic situation.
On a global scale.
Ruby Princess was considered low risk for COVID-19.
I've got it.
There were no New South Wales health officials present.
An absolutely inexcusable failure to do your job.
We're a company and an industry that does the right thing.
This is about controlling the spread.
How dare they?
It should have been kept contained. They obviously knew what we didn't. We've been lied to.
The ship followed to the letter all of the formal health clearance processes.
Hell no.
This document is the smoking gun. A very different kind of interview.
Nobody says anything about anything.
Going to see your husband for the last time.
A disaster.
I can assure you now that all authorities are working together.
The welfare of our crew is paramount.
This is a cover-up.
Horrible, absolutely horrible.
I don't wish it on anyone.
It spreads really, really quickly.
No apology, no explanation.
The public needs to know facts.
I'd like to know why.
Nobody to be held responsible for it.
This is a very, very serious situation.
Just terrifying.
Well, there she is, the Ruby Princess, a breeding ground for the largest cluster of COVID-19 cases in the entire country. From here, it spread out to every state and territory. Tonight, how this virus was unleashed, who knew about it, and how it put every single one of us in danger.
There's a distinct timeline of things that shouldn't have happened. Crew shouldn't have happened. We shouldn't have been allowed to embark. We shouldn't have been allowed to disembark, and we should not have been allowed to leave the country. It should have been kept contained.
In good times, there's a good reason to book a cruise on the Ruby Princess. It has all the attractions. Even a consulting Australian celebrity chef. The Ruby Princess left no stone unturned.
So we get the best, freshest ingredients, and then we do it justice.
But these aren't the best of times. They're the worst. The coronavirus pandemic is sweeping the world, and one of the first wave of victims is on the Diamond Princess moored in Japan. 700 people test positive. There are multiple deaths. The Ruby Princess is its sister ship. The owner and the captain were well aware of the risk they faced, but stopping the cruisers would cost the company millions. So the ship sailed on. Early in March, in a bustling Sydney harbour full of cruise ships, the Ruby Princess returned from a New Zealand round trip. In the shipping business, time is money, and the Ruby Princess had one lot of passengers to disembark and thousands more to board, so the ship could leave again that night. The haste to leave would now set off a viral time bomb. 11 days later, it would detonate. I'm driving out now to meet a couple who booked and paid for that trip on the Ruby Princess. They are now both stuck at home, both testing positive to COVID-19. So I'm not exactly sure how I'm going to talk to them at this point. This is going to be a very different kind of interview. Hello, Bill.
How are you?
You in there somewhere?
No, I'm here. I'm not on the bloody Ruby Princess.
Yeah, I can imagine.
It's the very first time we've gone on a cruise, right? We've never had one before, and I thought, well, the wife, I'd like to give the wife a good holiday. Right from the very word go, there was something wrong. They've got a little saying of Ruby Princess, come back new. What a joke. What a joke, come back new. We've never been so crook. I've been 2 weeks. I've been in and out of bed all day, and it's just horrible, horrible, horrible.
Mm.
The cost of pain that goes with it.
Yeah.
Not funny.
Our guest could disembark Ruby Princess because that was the official health clearance process that existed at the time.
On March 8, the new arrivals were about to move into the cabins of the passengers who disembarked just hours before. Among them was Alyssa McCafferty, who was travelling with 5 others, including her elderly parents.
Mum's in a wheelchair, so it was really accessible for her. And she's always wanted to go to New Zealand. She's always wanted a cruise, but she's always wanted to go to New Zealand.
What the newcomers weren't told is just how many of the recently departed passengers had reported sick. 158 in total, 13 with high temperatures, a symptom of COVID-19. But despite the warning signs, the Ruby Princess would let on board 2,700 unsuspecting souls.
Our fundamental position is that the health and safety of our guests and our crew must always come first.
Only one of our group of 6 has tested negative, and our 6th member is currently in hospital down in Wollongong. He was admitted yesterday.
Did anybody tell you that the previous cruise, did they tell you that there was any problems on board, anyone sick from that cruise?
No, no, there was nobody sick, everything was okay, everything was good.
So people had asked the crew, asked Ruby Princess, how was the last cruise, was there anyone sick on board, and the answer was?
No, everything is good.
For all the Princess Cruise fans,
we're a company and an industry that does the right thing.
But I know we'll meet again some sunny day.
See you soon.
I think it was 6:30, maybe 7 o'clock, they made an announcement saying New South Wales Health have given permission for this cruise to board and depart.
Mm.
So, for all our minds, that meant it was safe to board. New South Wales Health
have cleared this boat to leave.
Yes. And everybody cheered.
From what we know about cruise ships, they are kind of petri dishes for the spread of infectious diseases. And it's very, very hard to stop the spread of that throughout that cruise ship. The thing about cruise ships is that they're very close, confined environment. In a normal community setting, you don't really have close contact with 3,000 other people at the same time, but on a cruise ship for a couple of weeks at least, in this confined place with these other people. You know, thousands of people on the ship sharing bathrooms, sharing common eating areas, sharing entertainment areas. There are lots and lots of opportunities for people to come in close contact with each other or touch potentially infected surfaces. People go to the toilet, flush the toilet, and that the virus gets aerosolized and can land on surfaces or the next person who goes into the toilet. It just seems like a cruise ship is kind of a perfect place for a virus to spread.
You set off a glitter bomb at a party, you're going to be finding glitter for years. That's what this virus is.
Ruby days pass. The ship travels from Sydney to New Zealand, the Fiordland, Dunedin, Akaroa, Wellington, and Napier.
My name's Elisa. I'm from Sydney, but I live in Reading in the UK with my husband over there.
Out at sea, as the virus silently spreads, the alarm bells are yet to ring. But back in Sydney, one person is getting seriously concerned. Ever since the Ruby Princess left, Sarah Marshall, a senior executive at the New South Wales Port Authority, has been trying to get Carnival Australia to answer a very simple question. Did the master of the vessel lie to them on March 8th? Remember, on March 8th, the Ruby Princess disembarked one load of passengers, only to take on another. But what the master of the vessel knew was no less than 158 of those passengers leaving the vessel were sick, 13 of them with a high temperature, a textbook symptom of COVID-19. But as this explosive email reveals, that information was kept from the Port Authority.
Last Sunday, 8th of March, the Ruby Princess arrived into port, advising our vessel traffic services they had no ill passengers or crew on board.
In other words, the Port Authority fears it has been misled.
It raised concerns about whether we can, in general, rely on the declaration from the master of the vessel.
But the Port Authority, they didn't stop there. They wrote to Carnival Australia, the owners of the Ruby Princess, and they asked a very simple, a very direct question. Why did the master of the vessel fail to declare the sick people he had on board?
We are still to receive a response.
Their question was unanswered, their fears ignored. And on board the Ruby Princess, the fever was beginning to rage.
There was one instance, we were in the theatre watching the show, and there was a seat between me and this particular lady. And all of a sudden, she let off this coughing, real deep coughing come from deep down. And I thought, this is not right, so anyway, I moved away from her. And I did take much more notice of it. But yeah, there was a few incidents there. There was another one with a cabin boy who'd been off for two days. When asked about it, they turned around and said, oh yeah, he had a sore throat, and that was about it. So yeah, not a very good experience.
You see, you can't just trust a captain to be honest or dishonest. You have to have a second line of proving the facts. And what needed to happen here was the automatic and immediate implementation of total testing for the 3,000 or so people on this floating petri dish to establish how many people were sick.
By March 14th, the Ruby Princess had been 6 days at sea when the New Zealand Prime Minister announced a ban on cruise ships arriving on New Zealand shores. New Zealand locks down its borders and the captain is running out of options. He has at least 13 patients on board with symptoms of COVID-19. So he scraps the itinerary and he charts a course directly for Sydney. The next day, Australian Prime Minister Scott Morrison announces a similar ban for Australia.
The Australian government will also ban cruise ships from foreign ports from arriving at Australian ports for initial 30 days, and that will go forward on a rolling basis.
And steaming back to Sydney is a viral time bomb.
What were you told at that point?
The Australian government wants us straight back home.
If you're a captain of a ship and you're arriving in Sydney, you got 2,700 people on board, at least 13 people seriously ill with a respiratory illness that presents like COVID-19. Do you let those people off the ship or do you quarantine the ship and keep people inside with the virus?
What we would do now is that we would isolate those people and quarantine the ship.
cruise ships at a time when you've got a communicable disease are floating petri dishes. And what's happened is we've allowed this floating petri dish to descend on Australia's gateway, Sydney, a city of 5 million people, and then disseminate the petri dish right across Australia to country towns and other cities across our vast nation. Now, look, in a crisis, I fully understand, having been Prime Minister, mistakes will always be made. But on this one, where you had a clear case study as far as the Diamond Princess in Tokyo was concerned, and secondly, only a small number of entry ports to control, this is an inexcusable failure of public duty.
Welcome to Cruise Passenger. I'm Rosie Jacobs, and today we are on board the Ruby Princess. We're going to take you for a tour around this magical ship and show you all the features she has to offer. Let's go.
Hi, everyone. A lot's been said recently about Ruby Princess. I'd like to take a few moments to help you know and understand the facts.
They said they did everything according to the rules, they let everyone know as much as they could, and that they did their utmost for their passengers. What do you think about that?
As we now know, some of the swabs from Ruby Princess tested positive. This news was as disappointing as it was unexpected.
Not one word was said about anyone on board having the virus. The only thing they did say was, if you're feeling sick, if you've got a temperature, or if you've got a cough, go and see the doctor during business hours.
On March 16th, Ruby Princess left New Zealand to head back to Sydney. On board, passengers were already falling ill, information that wasn't immediately shared by the crew or the company.
Should Australians be outraged? Absolutely. This was avoidable. We've now got something like 5,000 coronavirus infections in Australia. So far, about 10% of them come from this single ship.
Still unaware of the danger they're in, the 2,700 passengers make the most of their final days at sea.
And you'd think there would be rumours, but no, no rumours. A lot of alcohol consumed, but no rumours.
Alice! Who the
f***
is Alice?
Tequila kills everything.
By the time that ship left New Zealand, there were already 13 passengers on board with COVID-19 symptoms, and those 13 passengers had been advised to have nasal swabs ready to go for when they got back to Australia. So that ship knew that there were people on board who were very ill and most likely with COVID-19.
That is news to me and very sad, because those swabs could have been taken and chop it off. So results could have been had, if that was the case, before we even got back to Sydney. We could have known whether or not the ship should have been in full quarantine.
In the bridge deck, as he approaches Sydney, the captain must realise his dilemma. He has 2,700 people on board, and they are all under his care.
The question now for the ship: should it be quarantined, or should the thousands of passengers be let loose in the centre of Sydney?
So it's our last morning in Sydney. It's about 6:30 a.m. We'll be able to disembark in about an hour 15.
I couldn't sleep, so I went up to the top deck, and there were probably about 20 of us up on the top deck, watching us come into Sydney.
As you can see behind me, we've got the Opera House, and you can see behind the Opera House the ship that's been taking the firefighters from the Sydney bushfires.
sad to be home. Because Sydney is still home for me, even though I live in the UK. Sydney, like, coming home is, you know, it always makes, you know, tears you up. It does. Can't help it.
And, Dad, this is for you. Oh, Danny boy, the pipes are calling. From glen to glen and down the mountainside. The summer's gone and all the roses fallen. It's you must go and I must buy. But call me back.
Australian lives, hundreds, potentially thousands, have been put at risk because of the failure of Mr. Morrison and Mr. Dutton to do their job.
It's I'll be here in sunshine or in shadow. Oh, Danny boy, oh, Danny boy, I love you so.
And you suck for making me cry, you bastard. Love you.
Remember, Mr. Morrison and Mr. Dutton built their political careers around the catch cry of we will stop the boat. Well, on this occasion, they had one job, which was to stop one giant boat arriving at Sydney Harbour, and they failed.
The ship isn't stopped. Despite the deadly example of the Diamond Princess in Japan, despite Prime Minister Morrison closing all the ports, including this one, despite the passengers on board being clearly ill, multiple mistakes by multiple authorities, and it put us all at risk. Mistakes? Carnival Australia admits to none of them.
Ruby Princess fully reported its health status using the official federal and state maritime reporting systems.
The ship followed to the letter all of the formal health clearance processes that were active at that time.
But this isn't the complete picture.
Carnival Australia knew there was something seriously wrong. I know this because when the Ruby Princess arrived on this very dock in the dead of night, there was an ambulance waiting right here to take a seriously ill passenger to hospital. So, who called it in? A New South Wales government minister has told us the call came from no less than the headquarters of Carnival Australia. To quote the minister, they wanted an ambulance and they wanted it quickly.
Within hours, that passenger was in ICU. Within days, she was dead. Killed by COVID-19.
I knew there was an ambulance down there, we'd seen it, but I thought it was for a passenger that had had a fall, because there's quite often people who have falls, but I was not aware that it was, at the time, that it was for a COVID patient.
How does that make you feel at this point in time?
Lied to.
Ruby Princess was considered low risk for COVID-19 when she returned to Sydney last week.
The cruise company knew enough to call an ambulance for a very sick woman on board who later died from COVID-19. So they knew exactly what they had on board, yet they did not say a word to any of those passengers.
It's grossly irresponsible and probably illegal for passengers not to be informed that they were floating around on an infected petri dish of COVID-19.
The arrival of our guest that day was no different to other travellers arriving in Australia by air from overseas.
Was there anything about leaving the vessel that stood out to you? Anything unusual?
Just how quickly they got us off.
We were just rushed up like sheep. Touching each other.
Jammed in.
There was no getting away from one or the other. No, there was no indication of saying keep so much distance between each other. No, nothing whatsoever.
Did you see anyone from Border Force?
Saw Border Force agents around with masks and gloves, but they didn't interact. They basically just stood there and kept telling people to move through. Nothing was being scanned. I couldn't see anyone's temperatures being taken. We weren't asked to fill in another health declaration.
There was no checking of passports. There was no checking of anything.
Our passports weren't even checked getting off the ship. It was get us out. get us off and away and out.
Everything is OK. No problems. There's nothing going on. Everything is all right. See you later. Hooroo.
At a minimum, we should have applied mandatory testing for all 3,000-plus people on board. That's the only way you'll know the truth. Rather than saying, off you go, catch a bus up to Newcastle, catch the plane to Brizzy, give your mum and dad a kiss and a cuddle when you get home, and Bob's your uncle.
Elissa, her mother and father, got a hire car to Sydney Airport, went to the Qantas lounge, had a drink at the bar before boarding a packed flight to London, where they caught a cab home. All three of them were infected and contagious.
As sensible humans, we don't want to infect people. We don't want to cause harm or hurt other people. Being told that we could travel meant, OK, we can travel. The government says we can travel. It's safe to travel. But it obviously wasn't.
2,700 passengers, in a matter of minutes, dumped in the centre of Sydney. They got picked up in cars. They caught cabs, buses, trains. And then came the passenger jets as they made their way home to friends and family, not just in New South Wales, but every state and territory. And overseas. New Zealand, Singapore, the United States, England, even Spain.
When I first got back to London on the Friday, I felt crap because I'd been on flights for 24 hours. But then come Friday night, the cough started getting really bad. And then come Saturday morning, it was just like, yeah, this isn't right. I've got it.
Still to come, explain to me how your resignation would not be on the desk of the Premier tomorrow morning. Ducking for cover.
Take a question from
you. You didn't answer the question from the start.
I answered the question. No, I'm in.
I think I know more than you think I know.
Hello, I'm Stuart Mirmel, President of Carnival Australia. In recent weeks, as COVID-19 started to spread to our north, we began bringing our Australian best ships back to Australia so that thousands of passengers could get safely back home. It was an orderly process that worked.
How many people died? That's been on their mind as well. That's the story that's really we've got a decent family looking after us. The pain that goes with it, you have no idea. Difficulty breathing, temperature rising.
How bad is it?
I don't wish it on anyone.
Bill, are you worried about your wife?
Of course I am.
You said that she's too ill to come to the window. How bad is she? You must be incredibly concerned.
I am. That's just the whole thing. She's just not there. We've been married for 54 years. She's the best woman in this world. I am a very, very lucky man to have a lady like I am. And for somebody to have to do that, it's just not right. It's not fair.
The way its tentacles have spread right across the country, it reaches into the lives of just ordinary people. Friends of ours, a lady, was on this ship, didn't know she had the virus, landed in Sydney, no instructions, no nothing, flew back to Brisbane, and to her horror, infected other members of her family, including her husband, who I'm advised is now in hospital.
It's amounted for 10% of COVID infections in Australia. All because Gladys Berejiklian and Brad Hazzard...
Good morning, everybody. Thank you for coming along.
..went above and beyond federal government policy.
My question is to the Prime Minister. Who is responsible for allowing passengers to disembark the Ruby Princess cruise ship, many of whom are now presenting with coronavirus symptoms?
You see, what happens often in public politics is that people play past the parcel.
There were no New South Wales health officials present.
It was him. It was her. It was them.
New South Wales Health has stated that it undertook a full assessment of the Ruby Princess and allowed the passengers to disembark.
New South Wales Health responded to the Ruby Princess and stated, you are free to disembark tomorrow.
And then there's this, a damning document from the Federal Department of Agriculture, the people responsible for Australia's biosecurity. It reveals the Ruby Princess declared it had 128 people fall ill on the cruise to New Zealand. 24 of those had a temperature of well over 38 degrees. Six of them had headaches, muscle aches, vomiting. This information was passed from the ship to the New South Wales Department of Health prior to her docking in Circular Quay on March 19th.
OK, happy to take questions. Thank you for the chance.
In relation to the Ruby Princess, I know the exact figures that your department was given in relation to the sick people that were on board that boat, more than 100 people, and many of them suffering from symptoms of COVID-19. That 2,700 passengers were dumped into the middle of Sydney, and we know what happened after that. Explain to me how your resignation would not be on the desk of the Premier tomorrow morning.
Can I just say that the experts who made the issue, who made the decision, were the best in the world.
In your department or on the boat?
The health department. I'll take you through it because it sounds like you don't actually know how it works. I'll just take you through it.
I think I know more than you think I know.
It's all right. So the decision that they took was a decision that was made by medical professionals of the highest calibre. And from that advice, we can convey it to you. We don't make the decisions. I saw somewhere that someone said, I made the decision on the Ruby Princess. I didn't know anything about the Ruby Princess. I was dealing with all of the other issues that were obviously being dealt with. I had no knowledge until the day after or the day after that when I was advised that there were, I think...
Minister, the Diamond Princess was a disaster, but it didn't travel beyond the Diamond Princess.
Take a question from
you. You didn't answer the question from the start. I'm asking you a question or follow-up question.
You want to answer that?
No, I want to answer the question.
OK, sorry. Chris, can I allow Dr. Chant, because there's a level of enthusiasm here.
As the Minister indicated, a panel of public health doctors do the risk assessment on the ship, and that is the process. Obviously, if there are learnings and insights that we will gather, those will be reflected. The actions of New South Wales Health on that day and the advice of the public health panel was based on the assessment of that information presented to them. They concluded it was a low risk, took the action and tested the results.
Thank you, everybody, and I'll see you tomorrow, OK? Thank you.
The minister, a politician's answer is what I'm hearing. You can't seriously say that passengers that were let off the Ruby Princess, that went home, that infected family members, that stayed at home for 7 days and went to hospital and died a few days later, those lives might have been saved. You can't seriously back the decision of his department on that.
To look out for your overall health and well-being, we have enhanced our pre-boarding and onboard health protocols. Our advanced sanitation response protocols serve as our foundational basis and comprehensive practice, and they can keep our ships healthy and clean.
So we don't think much of it. They're off having a great time. So every night they went to dinner. I think they basically went to the same place for dinner every night, got the same waiter every night. One night they turned up, waiter's far and gone. Oh, where's the waiter? Oh, he's sick. And that was it. After that, he was gone. They wouldn't say anything where he was or what was wrong with him. So I suspect that he was from one of them.
Into my arms, oh Lord, into my arms.
It was probably the week after they got back. She just said Des has had a bit of a cold or something. May not have been feeling 100%, but still was okay.
his temperature was going up, and on the Saturday, I think he had a high temperature, starting to have difficulty breathing as well then. So they're like, well, we need to do something. So they went to the local testing station in Toowoomba. It was only then, once he got in the hospital, tested him, and he found out he had it the next day. He was straight away put in the COVID ward. Mum at that stage, still being in isolation at home, still trying to see her for 14 days, was told, you just have to stay at home, you can't come and see him. Helpless, feeling helpless. Husband's basically got the disease, and she can't go and see him. So, you know, I basically had to go and take up his phone and his iPad for him so she could at least have some communication with him. And, you know, that's a big risk for us, going to the hospital and into that area. Then on the Tuesday, so it's Tuesday, just gone, his oxygen level dropped again, and they put him on back on oxygen. And then just out of the blue that night, the doctor said, Des is dying. Des is dying. You need to come and see him. So, she can't get in a taxi. I can't pick her up. Can't do anything. So she had to drive herself. Going to see your husband for the last time. She went and saw him 10 o'clock on the Tuesday night. It was Thursday morning, 2:30 a.m. that he died, so a bit over 24 hours. He was apparently talking to the nurses. Des was talking to the nurses every half an hour when they come and checked him, and the next time the nurse went back, he was dead. So, and then she had to go up and see the body anyway, so saw Des.
If there turns out there's decisions that have been made by various departments, by this cruise company, that have put your parents in peril, what have those decisions done to your family?
Well, they've decimated our family. You know, we've got a 6-year-old and a 4-year-old, and they used to love seeing Des, so now their grandfather's taken away. Yeah. My stepfather's taken away as well. You know, we got on really well, and my mother loved him, so the whole bloody thing has just decimated the family. And, you know, and as we talk now, it hasn't fine ended, so just disaster. And then, yep, the clinger now is Mum's tested positive yesterday afternoon.
Craig, I'm so sorry for you and the family. I really am.
The whole nightmare. Whole nightmare's still on. She's showing no symptoms, but we've got to now just wait and see if the bloody death sentence is coming. So we're all just stressed like anything. Right now, she's preparing, you know, herself for the end, essentially. Yeah, and we can't go over. Well, we can go over there and see her from a distance, but we can't hug her, we can't do anything, we can't go inside and help her. She's just lonely and, you know, hopefully not dying.
Spare a thought tonight for the crew on board the Ruby Princess, a ship without a port, passengers without a destination. They've been drifting up and down the Sydney coast with the virus quite literally jumping from room to room. The only way they get off is in an ambulance, in the dead of night, at boat ramps like this. There's a forgotten bunch of people in all this, and that is the crew that is still on board that ship.
Yeah. I'm in touch with a few of them. Can I read you something that one of them sent me?
Please.
I can't say who sent it because they're basically gagged. So what he said is, try to fight our corner a little if you can. The only thing that we're upset about is the negative press.
There's 1,100 crew on board that ship. Do you know how many of them are ill?
I don't know how many are sick. From what I've been told, all but about 200 are in isolation, and that other 200 are basically keeping everything running, keeping everyone fed. and, you know, working their asses off to try and keep everything just going.
Goes across the fort, the faith, might have fallen, major lift, the battleful king composing, hallelujah.
On the 19th of March, on a beautiful Sydney day, after dropping its passengers, the Ruby Princess prepared to set sail. On deck, there was an emotional ceremony.
Your faith was strong, we needed proof. You're bathing on the roof. Her beauty and the moonlight overthrew you.
The crew were happy and relieved to be leaving.
She broke your thumb and she cut your hair. And from your lips she drew.
We sailed away from Sydney on the 19th, believing we were virus-free.
As these secret texts from those now trapped on board reveal.
We had a deck party because we had been cleared by New South Wales Health. The party lasted one day.
We've been locked down ever since.
On the Ruby, there's like three doctors and three nurses who are now working around the clock trying to look after, you know, over 1,100 people, 1,200 people. That's inhumane.
Ruby Princess, Ruby Princess, Ruby Princess. This is helicopter, uniform, Alpha, Zulu. How is your status on board? Over.
Mate, stand by. We'll get back to you shortly. Just stand by. Excuse me, can you just tell me, which kind of organisation do you belong? Are you from the New South Wales Health?
We are not New South Wales Health, no. But we are concerned about the people you have on board, checking to see that everything is okay, and for a general health check, over.
Uniform Alpha Zulu, Ruby Princess. So all our health reports have been already submitted and, we're dealing already with New South Wales Health Department. There's no need for any further report.
Can I ask, do you have anyone else on board who is ill? Over.
Sir, I repeat, all relevant information have been already submitted to relevant health department. Assure there is no need at this stage for any other report.
Captain, your personal opinion, are you happy with the responses you've had from New South Wales Health and Australian authorities? Over.
Okay, I'll repeat again, there is no need for any opinion or any report at this stage. All relevant information regarding our opinion have been already passed to the authorities ashore. Thank you very much, sir. I believe this is the end of the conversation.
We are a hard-working bunch from 51 nations that day in and day out spend our lives fulfilling the dreams of our guests, and now we're treated like this?
They're humans. Let them off. Don't keep them stranded off the coast. Sorry, pisses me off a little. The damage has been done. Let them off.
Thank you.
this virus is different, and it's sort of different to anything we've seen before. And we don't have any immunity to it.
This has to be a seminal learning for the next virus or the next border-related security incident.
If my travelling home infected someone else and they infected someone else, and if I've helped perpetuate this horrible virus, that's something I'm going to have to live with.
Mr. Tough Guy, Captain Tough Guy, Peter Dutton, out to make his reputation through being the meanest, hungriest minister in the government. Yet, it's on his watch that this has happened through his agency.
Why weren't we told? Why weren't we taken care of? What can you do now? What's going to happen? What is going to happen?
Yeah.
Is the government going to take responsibility?
But after the blame game, we need to learn. Australia had an opportunity to slow the spread of COVID-19. It was more than an opportunity, really. It was a duty to protect all of us. A company failed, agencies failed, ministers failed. Contagion spread and lives were lost. The first step is to admit the mistakes. The second, make sure they never happen again.